This week is the week of Eid al-Adha, which is linked to Hajj, and that is linked to Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Ibrahim is known as Khalilullah, the friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As well as there is a very famous title that Muslims use for him, where they say he is Abul Anbiya, he's the father of the Anbiya, the descendants that he had in Bani Israel, and of course our own Prophet. There are many, many Anbiya among them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually has mentioned him by name 69 times in the Quran. Our Prophet has been mentioned only 4 times. You know, it's just a point. Sometimes people say, oh, you know, this thing has been mentioned more than this. Well, don't look at numbers as a basis of, you know, the status. Everything has its own place. So Ibrahim alayhi salam has been mentioned 69 times by the name. And his mention besides the name is even more than that. The relationship that Muslims have, Islam, has with Ibrahim alayhi salam is part of our religious teachings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Imran, the third surah, ayah 67-68, very clearly talks about this issue, مَا كَانَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ يَهُودِيًّا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًّا. Ibrahim was not a Jew or a Christian. You know, Judaism and Christianity came later on, historically. وَلَكِنْ كَانَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا. This is a very beautiful way of describing it. He was Hanif. Hanif and Musliman means an upright person who submitted to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here, Muslim is not in the technical meaning. This is in a literal sense. Hanif and Musliman. An upright person who submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Of course, he was not among the polytheists or the idol worshippers. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says something very interesting there, very bold statement. And we don't have to shy away from what Quran says. إِنَّ أَوْلَى النَّاسِ بِإِبْرَاهِيمِ لَلَّذِي اتَّبَعُوهُ وَهَذَا النَّبِي وَالَّذِي آمَنُوا وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Those who can truly say they are with Ibrahim, closer to Ibrahim, are those who actually truly followed him. Especially this Nabi, referring to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And the believers, the mu'mineen who followed the Prophet on this issue. وَاللَّهُ وَلِيُّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah is the master of the guardian of the believers. And this term, Hanif, the plural is Hanafa. And this has been even used in our books, in the Muslim books, that what was the religion of the ancestors of the Prophet? They were not followers of the line of Bani Israel, so they were not Yehud or Nasara. But we believe that the direct line of the ancestors of Rasulullah were all, you know, Muwahideen. They believed in one God. And so what was their religion? We call them Hunafa. You know, they followed the upright religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So that path goes straight from Ibrahim alayhi salam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salawat, brother. In Surah Hajj, he actually says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you are so close to Ibrahim in your relationship that, you know, after saying to the believers, do ruku, do sajda, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do good, and do jihad and struggle in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, huwa ishtabakum, he is the one who has chosen you. وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنَ حَرَجٍ. And he has not put any, you know, a burden on you when it comes to hardship in your religion. Which is your religion? Millata abikum Ibrahim. Your religion is the religion of your forefather Ibrahim, وَهُوَ سَمَّاكُمُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. And before even you came to exist as a Muslim community, Ibrahim had already named you as Muslims. So even the name Muslims for us comes from Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this is where we look at this relationship that is very clear for us. And in Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ahzab, ayah 21, where he says that in the person of your prophet, there is uswa hasana, good example for you to follow. He also mentions in Surah number 60, ayat 4, about Ibrahim, same things. He says, وَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمُ وَالَّذِينَ مَعْهُ. That yes, your Rasul is an example for you, but also remember Ibrahim and those who truly believed in him. In their life also you have good example. So Uswa Hasana is also for Ibrahim alayhi salam and his life. And if you see, this is reflected in the Muslim teachings. Many things we take for granted, we do not realize what is the origin of that. I'm sure I'll give you the list here of 10 things which are known as Sunnat of Ibrahim. I mean, these are the traditions that we have adapted, but originally they come from Ibrahim alayhi salam. 5 of them actually are related to our head. Combing of the hair. And you'll say, what has this to do with religion? Well, Islam is a religion which talks about everything. Even if you don't have it, just, you know, use it. Qurbatan lillah, you get sawab for it. Don't worry. You know? And so the issue of, you know, combing the hair, keeping yourself, you know, presentable, especially when you go to masjid to do the ibadat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, even when you come to me, nothing is hidden from me, but I would like you to come to the masajid with the zinat. There is an ayat of Quran. وَخُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ. You know, come in a very presentable manner. And so even when we interact with one another, so that's one sign of it. Second, keeping the beard. This tradition that we have, especially in Islam, this is the tradition of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Trimming the mustache. The third sunnah that we have. Then we go on to the mouth. Brushing the teeth. This is actually a sunnah which has continued in Islam from Ibrahim alayhi salam. The Prophet was so much, you know, insistent on this issue that he says something, and I think all, you know, Shia Muslim doctors should have this hadith in their clinic. And the hadith says that the Prophet said, if I did not find that my community would go into inconvenience, I would have made it wajib for them to brush their teeth 5 times before wudu every day. The dentist tell us 3 times, huh? Rasulullah is saying 5 times. I wish, you know, we would have followed that. At least I'm talking about myself. We wouldn't have to go to that dentist, you know, so many times. But this is the issue that, you know, the Prophet emphasized on this point, that if I had not found this issue to become inconvenient for the Ummah, I would have made it wajib, you know, to brush their teeth 5 times according to the 5 prayers. And the fifth one is the issue of using the toothpick after eating. So this hygiene of the mouth is also an important element as far as the Sunnat of Ibrahim is concerned. Coming to the rest of the body, number one, washing ourselves with water, you know, after going through the process, which is a very natural one. So use of water is actually a Sunnat of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Even the tradition of ghusl has come in Islam from Ibrahim alayhi salam. Clipping of the nails is again a sunnah of Ibrahim. getting rid of bodily hair. That's also considered to be a sunnah in Islam, and circumcision for boys. Of course, when we look at this sunnah, you know, many of these things we already do or we know, but it's important to know that, you know, when we talk about the message of Islam, this is something which is continued through the Anbiya, especially this link of Islam to Prophet Ibrahim Khalilullah alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat malik parawar. Of course, even in the simple sunnah that we do on a personal level, you know, now we are facing challenges. You know, the era where God is being replaced with yourself, where you become the one who will decide what you want, what is right, what is wrong. You know, that we see that even, for example, there is a movement now that the parents don't have a right when a newborn baby is born to write the gender in the application of the birth certificate. Or at least the birth certificate should not reflect. Let the child grow up and decide, I am this or that. You know, just think about it, where this modern society is moving in that direction. I remember at a time when, as a one of the you know, individuals allowed to sign on the marriage license, official one, the forms used to come out, were printed very clearly. You had the particulars of the groom and the bride. And when the law changed here in Canada, the forms were changed. It says applicant and co-applicant. You don't know who is who. You know, and so these are the issues that we face, and I hope religious communities, including the Jewish community and the Christian community, comes up and stands up for the values that we have, inshallah. إن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف على العباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. As I mentioned earlier, Hajj is totally, you know, related to the Sunnah and the Seerah of Ibrahim alayhi salam, especially when we talk about the sacrifice which is done on that day known as Eid al-Adha. Adha actually refers to this meaning of sacrifice of the animal. So even the name itself is linked to the sacrifice that Muslims do on that day in remembrance of the sacrifice of Ibrahim alayhi salam. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he was hanifan musliman, an upright Muslim, who submitted to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the most obvious example and a very powerful one is the issue of this whole process of sacrifice. Of course, Allah, in his knowledge, didn't intend that Ibrahim would slaughter Ismail. But he wanted to see, is he willing to do this or not? And so his dream would only come to the point. That is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Ibrahim alayhi salam in the dream. We are told that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala communicates with the anbiya in different ways, 3 to 4 ways, and one of them is through dream. As I say many times, it's very different from our own dreams. You know, you have good biryani, you see dreams, but that's not the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a nabi. And so when he saw this in the dream, that he's, you know, putting the knife on his neck of his son 3 times. You know, this is where the story goes on, that Ibrahim had become 90 years old, no child. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbi habli min as-salihin, that oh Allah, give me a child from the good doers. فَبَشَّرْنَاهُ بِغُلَامٍ حَلِيمٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, you know, we gave him the good news. This is surah number 37, ayat 100 to 110. This is where Allah says we gave him a good news of a boy who will be halim. Halim means who is forbearing. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعْهُ السَّعِيِ. So first of all, Allah blesses him with a child after he's 90 years old. And now that he's happy, Allah has given me a son. Now that this son reaches to the age where he can help him in building the Kaaba. There, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now asked him through the dream that you have to sacrifice this son. قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ. O my son, you know, I see in the dream that I'm slaughtering you. فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. So let me know, what do you think about it? Remember, it's a dual imtihan. It's for Ibrahim as well as Ismail. So he has to be part of this process. And so this is where we see that Ibrahim alayhi salam is not saying, I have to do this. Look at this father-son, you know, communication. This is tarbiyat. He says, you know, فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. Think about it, ponder on it, and let me know, what do you think? The answer is there immediately. قَالَ يَا أَبَتِ فَعَفْ مَا تُؤْمَرْ. That, oh my father, do what you have been commanded to do. If Allah is the one ordering you, then you do it. سَتَجِدَنِي إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ. You will find me among those who are sabir, who are patient in this test and trial. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا, when both of them submitted. So it's not only Ibrahim, Ismail also. When both of them submitted, وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ, you know, basically then Ibrahim put him on the side. And of course, it was not an easy test. And so he put a blindfold on himself. Because he said, I will do it because Allah is asking me to do, but I cannot really see that. And so as far as he is concerned, he passed the, you know, basically used the knife there. But as we know the history, you know, when he opened his blindfold, he saw Ismail is standing there, you know, smiling, where there is a sheep in place of Ismail. And that is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَادَيْنَاهُ, we called out to him, يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ قَدْ صَدَّقْتُ الرُّؤْيَا, you made the dream come true. You only saw one part of it. You didn't see the conclusion. If he had seen the conclusion, it wouldn't be a test. So you made the dream come true, إِنَّ كَذَلِكَ نُجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ, and indeed we reward those who are good doers. And this was a very obvious, you know, al-bala' al-mubin, an obvious test for you. وَفَدَيْنَاهُ بِذِبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ وَتَرَكْنَاهُ عَلَيْهِ فِي الْآخِرِينَ سَلَامٌ عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمٍ. And this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then ends this whole passage, where he says, we replaced him, Ismail, with another great sacrifice. There are different levels of interpretation of this ayat. The obvious one is that, you know, Allah replaced a sheep, which Jibreel brought from the Jannah, for Ismail alayhi salam. And this is where we remember that day. This celebration is a celebration of the submission of Ibrahim alayhi salam to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we do the sacrifice for the pilgrims in Mina, it is wajib, part of the rituals. For the rest of the Muslims around the world, on that day, sacrifice of the sheep or a goat is actually recommended. It's not wajib. In Mina, every pilgrim has to do one sacrifice. Here, for example, if you're doing in Toronto, you can, you know, share one animal with, you know, two, three people. There is no problem. But you can't do that when you go for Hajj. Some people have done that by mistake, you know, trying to make it easier for them financially. But remember, in Hajj, you have to have one sacrifice for one Haji. And so that sacrifice itself is part of the divine teachings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to this ayat in the Quran, basically he says, this is about Hajj, وَالْبُدْنَ جَعَلْنَاهَ لَكُمْ مِنْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ لَكُمْ فِيهَا خَيْرٌ, that even this sacrificial animal that you have, camels or goat and sheep, you know, we have made them into symbols of Allah for you. شعائر الله. You know, these are the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the words used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not a simple matter here. You know, unfortunately, some people go through this process of the form and the spirit of Sharia. But look at these words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considers this sacrificial animal to be شعائر الله. And so he says, فَذْكُرُوا اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا. You know, when you're slaughtering the animal, you know, take the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the animal is down, means it has been slaughtered. فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا. Quran is saying, a portion of it, you and your family can eat. وَعَطْعِمُوا الْقَانِعِ وَالْمُعْتَزِ. And then feed the poor and the beggar. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about, this whole process of the sacrifice which is done by Muslims. It's not something which has been invented. It's part of our teachings. And alhamdulillah, you know, there are many, many orphans and poor and needy around the world. At least they get to eat meat during this time of Eid al-Adha. So if you really want to celebrate Eid al-Adha, you know, that is the meaning of the word Adha. You know, Adhiya, you know, these are the sacrificial animal that we are talking about. And so just to connect this issue, that when we talk about, you know, being part of the Abrahamic faith, yes, we are there and we believe, according to the words of the Quran, we are closer in following the Sunnah of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. وعلى إمام المتقين وعمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها. وعلى سيد شباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ماحي أثار البدء والطغيان هادم أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آباء الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج وَقْحُ الْنَاظِرَنَا بَنَظَرَةٍ مِنَّ إِلَيْهِ وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُسْتَشْهِدِينَ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ اللَّهُمَّ اجْعَلْنَا مِمَّنْ يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ.